That works. Hey, it looks like it's recording. All right, awesome. Good morning, everybody. Welcome. Thank you for joining me for my market update webinar. So I'm going to be doing these every Monday afternoon at 3, every Wednesday morning at 11, and then you'll get my email on Fridays with my video update and the market rates of where they're at. My goal is to essentially continue adding to this presentation every time that I present it with new information. So if you came on Monday, 70% of what you see is going to be a repeat. 30% is going to be new, but this stuff is so complicated that I think hearing it twice or three times is only going to help. So I have a guest with me, Jeff Lee. Say good morning, Jeff.
Good morning, Jeff.
Right. Okay. Thank you for following instructions properly. So we'll see what we end up with on participants. I think we got up to like 19 or 20 on Monday. We're at 15 so far, but we've got, I believe, like 40 people that said they were going to join. So let's see if they're liars or not. All right. So I'm going to start with talking about what's going on with the mortgage market. A lot of information that I'm going to go through. It is pretty technical, and I'm going to stay at a really high level on what I'm covering for you. And then feel free to ask questions as we go. Please use the chat function for any questions that you have. That's going to be the easiest way to get questions to us. So feel free to post in the chat function, and every once in a while, I'll pay attention to the chat. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. All right, so we're going to go over a mortgage update, what's going on in the mortgage world. We're going to give you a title and escrow update, and then we're going to have time for Q&A. And again, I'll try and get to the questions throughout the conversation, but I may skip your questions if I feel like we're going to answer it anyway. So the first thing I want to do is give everybody a brief overview of what happened in the last month. First of all, it is April Fool's Day. I wish I could say that March was a joke. I think we all wish we could say March was a joke, but it wasn't. And so we have to deal with the reality of what happened. And so here's essentially what happened. The latter part of February, early first week of March, rates fell significantly. And it happened simply because the stock market started to weaken a little bit because of fears of the coronavirus and what it was meaning to import-export and challenges that were going on with the world economy. And that was driving down the 10-year treasury bond, and that drug mortgages down with it. And that was amazing. We had some amazing interest rates. The best day of the year, the best day of my career, was literally the second Monday in March, or whatever that was, the 9th. And we were at 2.99 on a 30-year fixed. I was locking people at 2.75 on a 15-year fixed. And then it all went away. Everybody tried to refinance at the exact same time, and banks got overwhelmed. They couldn't manage the amount of business that they brought in the door, and they arbitrarily raised interest rates in order to slow the tide of people wanting to do loans. It's supply and demand. It's very, very basic. You all understand it from Econ 101. So more people want your products and services, the higher you raise the price, it will scare off the people that were only chasing price. Therefore, you can make more profits while still serving at a high level of people that really want to do business with you. Because if you keep your prices too low, you're going to upset everybody by trying to do too much business for too many people. So banks got overwhelmed, they pulled back they raised their interest rates, but it created an unintended consequence and liquidity disappeared. And here's why. Because, and there's many reasons why, and I'm gonna go over them in very, very light detail through this whole time together. So the first challenge is when Wall Street invests in a mortgage, they're expecting to get monthly payments over a certain period of time. And because of the uncertainty that was coming out in the market at the beginning of the month with how low rates had fallen, Wall Street kind of said, well, wait a second. If I do a loan for somebody at 2.99 right now, and 6 months from now, rates fall to 1.99, that person's going to refinance. So is that 2.99 loan really something I want to buy and own when I'm worried somebody's going to pay us off really quickly and the money that Wall Street paid for that investment won't pay them back because they don't earn interest for a long enough period of time? And so Wall Street kind of stepped back and said, oh, I'm not really sure I want to buy mortgages anymore because I think we're going to have people paying us off really, really quickly. So then the Fed steps in to help. And now it exacerbates the problem because the Fed starts buying mortgage bonds because nobody else would buy mortgage bonds. And so now the Fed says, hey, if Wall Street wanted to invest in mortgages, I'll do it. But they bought so much in mortgage bonds that they exacerbated the problem of people paying off their mortgage really, really quickly. And so now the banks were worried about, hey, the Fed's buying all these bonds and we're still not going to make any money. That's fine. The Fed doesn't care about losing their money with a quick payoff, but the servicer does. Because the servicer, the person that receives the monthly payment every month, also counts on having that loan for a long period of time to make up what they paid for the servicing right. And so the servicing values dropped. And that made rates stay arbitrarily high, even though the Fed was buying mortgage bonds and the rates should have come down significantly. There's a big spread, and that spread still exists right now. Now we add another problem. Everything shuts down. We've got the statewide lockdown, basically a national lockdown, and the federal government and all your local government leaders are saying, hey, go for forbearance. Go ahead and delay your monthly payment. Your banks, we're gonna get all the banks to agree. By the way, they didn't get the banks to agree. They got Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac and FHA and VA to agree, and the banks had no choice. Here's the problem. The banks are on the hook in about 75% of those loans to write the check to the Wall Street investor, even if the homeowner doesn't pay their monthly payment. So now you're a bank and you're saying, okay, so I've got to not let somebody make their monthly payment. That's fine. I'll get my money back at some point down the road. That's fine. But I still got to write a check to pay the federal government or to pay whoever is the owner of that mortgage. I'm going to run out of money. And it's a problem that's happening right now with every single mortgage bank. Some of us are in much better positions than others, but it's a problem happening across the board with every single mortgage bank in that we are not a depository bank. So your big banks, they have deposits they can lean on. They can go to the Federal Reserve and borrow money if they're short. But if we've got to make monthly payments on mortgages, I don't have a deposit base to go after. I can't go to the federal government as Summit Funding. Quicken Mortgage can't. A lot of mortgage companies are not banks. So the problem is that the mortgage companies are running out of money. Now, I'll insert multiple times here why Summit Funding's in great position, and this is one of them. We're extremely well funded. We have zero debt, a huge amount of liquid assets. We're still burning through them, but we're in much better position than most of our peers are. And so we've got three different things that happened that in one way should be good, and they are good for the consumer, but it's created major turmoil for the mortgage banking industry, and it's caused rates to stay higher than where they should be right now. On top of that, with the shutdown and the coronavirus crisis, we now have fear of mortgages going into default. And so now you basically are a mortgage company or an investor or a servicer, and you really have three alternatives of what's going to happen when you take on a new mortgage. The first and preferred choice is that person pays their monthly payment every month for the next 5 years minimum, and then maybe they'll refinance or sell the house, but that's what banks count on, and that's what we hope would happen. But the other two options are that they are going to refinance in 6 months because rates drop significantly, or the third option being that they can't pay their mortgage payment. We have to pay the payment for them, and ultimately, maybe they aren't able to get a job again. Maybe there's a foreclosure involved. Who knows? Unfortunately, the banks are looking at it saying, wait a second, two out of three circumstances here, I'm in trouble. So I'm not real comfortable with these high-risk loans. So non-qualified mortgages have now completely gone away. So a non-qualified mortgage prior to, let me back up and say, non-QM, is just the new word for subprime. So you've heard people say, hey, we've got stated income again. You can use bank statements to prove your income. You can, on an investment property, as long as the investment property rental income is enough to cover the mortgage payment, we're good. You don't need to care about the rest of your debt to income ratio. Well, all of those loan programs literally disappeared a week and a half ago. There is not a single lender offering them anymore. They all went away within a 48-hour timeframe. And that includes deals that were ready to fund. If it had funded, let me back up. That includes deals that have funded and didn't record. They were pulling wires back. They were saying, hey, Jeff, have your company recorded that yet? If not, please send us the wire back. We're unfunding this loan. Guys, this is back to 2008 kind of stuff, and this has happened in the last 10 days. So non-QM is completely gone. Jumbo loans are almost completely gone. So I went from 11 investors 2 weeks ago that I could, and I'm not talking about brokering a loan. I'm talking about controlling it in-house, underwriting the loan in-house, funding it in-house, and then selling it to one of these 11 investors. So I had complete control. Today, 9 of those 11 are gone. I have two jumbo investors left. And of those two investors, none of them will go above 80% loan to value. And oh, by the way, if you have a jumbo loan and you want to get a refinance, don't ask for cash out, because none of those investors will give you cash out on a jumbo loan either. The market has tightened significantly. FHA and VA have also been severely impacted, and I'll explain why in a couple of minutes. So now the Fed provides massive help again. The Fed basically last week on Monday said, we're going to write unlimited checks to make the value of mortgage bonds go up. That should, when values of bonds go up, the interest rate goes down. That should be a good thing, but it created yet another unintended consequence. Again, guys, this is relatively complicated. I'm going to be super, super simple in how I explain it. So it created something called a margin call. And very simply, when a bank like Summit Funding locks a loan, the truth is we're doing nothing other than making a promise. But we're making a promise based on an unknown, because we're really not selling that loan to the investor for at least 60 days. Because if it's a 30-day escrow, we then have 2 to 4 weeks after the close of escrow to actually get it put into a pool of mortgages, and that pool is sold to Wall Street. And so we're really not knowing how much money we're going to make on the mortgage until 2 months after we locked it. How in the world can we exist? We exist by doing something called hedging. Hedging means, as a mortgage bank, we buy an investment that gets more valuable when rates go up. And so if you think about it, here's the interest rate of the loan that we promised. Well, if we deliver that loan later and the market rates are significantly higher, Wall Street's not going to pay us very much, because we're going to go to Wall Street and say, hey, I promised somebody 2.99, but the truth is right now you guys are buying loans only at 3.5. Wall Street's not going to be very happy that we give them a 2.99 rate. So they're not going to pay us very much money for that mortgage. But we made up for it because on the hedge, we bought an investment that also goes up in value when this interest rate goes up. So we lost money from Wall Street over here, but we made money on this investment. Okay. Very, very oversimplified, but that's very simply how a mortgage bank operates. The other holds true. If rates drop significantly, well, then guess what? We get to go to Wall Street and say, hey guys, I know you only wanted mortgages at 2.5 today, but I got one at 2.99. You're going to pay me extra for that, right? In a normal market, they'd say, of course we would. That's going to pay us more money than what we expected to earn. But a couple of challenges come in here. So first of all, if that interest rate drops, so does the value of the hedge. Because remember, the hedge becomes more valuable if rates go up. But no big deal. So we lost some money on the hedge. We made up money on the lower interest rate when market rates went down. We don't care, because what we lost on the hedge, we made up for over here. Or if rates go up, what we lost on rates, we made up for on the hedge. We're not making extra money. We're just breaking even. And that's all we care about is, I promised a rate today. I know how much money we're going to earn as profit in the end, because no matter where rates go, we can balance that with the hedge. But here's where a margin call comes in. Remember how I said that hedge gets more valuable if rates go up? But the Federal Reserve is driving down the value of mortgage bonds, or increasing the value, driving down the rate on mortgage bonds. So very simply, we've got Wall Street investors calling us right now, the ones that we invested on the hedge, and said, hey gang, this hedge has lost so much value, we're not going to wait until you sell that mortgage to make up for it, because there's a limit to how much money you can lose when we're short selling bonds, is essentially what we're doing. And so there's a limit on how much money we can lose. So Wall Street is calling mortgage banks every day over the last 2 weeks saying, hey, can you wire me $250,000? Hey, can you wire me $2.5 million? And you literally have a matter of hours to wire that money. That's creating a significant liquidity crisis where mortgage banks literally are running out of money. And it's happening across the country. Okay. So now I'm going to go a little bit further. Actually, I already covered all this. Cool. See, I get ahead of myself. All right. So day one, we lock the interest rate. We buy a hedge. Day 30, we fund the loan. We fund it on a warehouse line of credits. Okay. That's kind of like a big old Amex card. And so we're writing a check out of this American Express account, and that pays for the mortgage. That's how we fund it. That's where we wire the money to Jeff and Chicago Title. And then we have to pay back. Hi, Jeff. We have to pay back the money once we sell it to Wall Street, which is typically about 2 weeks from then. At the time we fund the loan, though, we've paid all loan-related expenses. We've paid the loan officer commission. We've paid all of the fees related with the funding and closing of the loan, but we're not paid back until day 45, about 15 days after closing. But sometimes it takes longer to sell loans on the market. And so right now, because so many people are doing mortgages, it's starting to take longer and longer for banks to sell the loan to Wall Street. Why does that matter? Because how do we pay off that big old American Express card when we have now, instead of 15 days worth of loans that are on there and every 15 days we pay them off, now we've got 30, 45, or 60 days worth of loans, and that credit limit on that credit card on the warehouse line of credit doesn't go up. And as a matter of fact, that warehouse line of credit is based on the value of your company. And on the prior slide, I just told you how mortgage banks are losing cash right now. They're bleeding cash. That means they're not as valuable. And when they're bleeding cash and they aren't as valuable, they are cutting back the warehouse line of credits. I will not name names, but I have been following a lot of my peers across the country, and I've already heard of mortgage banks not funding loans and making up excuses why they're not funding. I'm talking about after the loan has signed, after everybody's ready to fund, and the bank says, yep, we wired the money. But it's kind of like going to Target. You can't go to Target anymore. Remember the days when you used to be able to go to Target and shop for stuff? Okay, pretend it was back in the day when you used to be able to go to Target, and you'd get a big old cart full of stuff, and you'd get to the checkout line, and you'd have them ring you up, and you're ready to walk out the door, and the last thing you gotta do is swipe your credit card. And then the dreaded beep on the machine says there's no money left on the credit card. That's what's happening right now, gang. The bank is saying, yep, we wired the money, we're good. And when they hit the button to wire the money, the warehouse bank comes back 2 hours later and says, rejected, you don't have enough money on your line of credit, you are overdrawn. And now they start making up excuses on why they aren't funding the loan. They're hoping and praying that tomorrow they're going to sell enough of the current loans they've already closed to Wall Street to pay off enough money on the warehouse line of credit so that they can actually fund that loan tomorrow. And they're not going to tell you the truth. So you need to be concerned if somebody says they funded and the wire doesn't show up. Okay, it is happening. Unfortunately, it's going to keep happening. And at some point, unfortunately, there's going to be some banks that have to close for that reason, because they literally, their warehouse lines have been trimmed back so much. They have so much an outstanding debt owed on the warehouse line that the warehouse line of credit can literally shut them down. That is a serious concern in the mortgage market today. All right, so problems with volatility, because rates have been moving up and down. The Fed's been buying a lot and buying a lot of mortgages. So I talked about margin calls on the hedge if rates drop too much. Here's the second problem. Borrowers want to renegotiate the lock. Now think about that for a second. We said we're going to promise you a 3.5% interest rate. And we bought a hedge position so that if that rate goes up, we make money on the hedge and we break even. If the rate drops, we lose money on the hedge, but we made money on the lock. But if the borrower says, hey, I'm going to cancel my loan unless you lower my rate. Well, first of all, most of the time we're going to let them cancel the loan. And I hate to say that, but the reason why is because if we let them lower their rate, we're going to continue to lose money on the hedge, and now we don't make as much money on the lock. And if we hold firm and say, you know what, forget it. If you want to leave, then leave. Well, then half of them aren't going to leave. They're just playing hardball, and we're not going to lose any money on those. And the ones that do leave, well, then we lost some money on the hedge, but we build that into our cost of doing business. So borrowers wanting to renegotiate the lock is a significant challenge in a volatile market, because borrowers just feel like, hey, the rate's lower. I deserve that lower rate. But they wouldn't be very happy if we called them and said, hey, the rate's higher, and we forgot to hedge it because we were afraid rates are going to drop and we didn't want to get screwed in the end. So therefore, we didn't hedge the lock, and now we're going to have to give you a higher rate. Borrowers wouldn't be very happy with that. And so that's a challenge mortgage banks inherently have had for years and years and years, and we will continue to have it. But you've got to understand, right now, it is a crisis of liquidity in mortgage banking. And if we don't all work together, the system literally can collapse. And I'm not over-exaggerating when I say that. All right. So extended time to sell loans. I talked about that challenge. I'll say that as of yesterday, Summit Funding made a decision. We are going to service 100% of our loans going forward. We're in a position to do that. We just choose not to service all of them, because when you sell a loan, we get cash back immediately. When you service a loan, you only get cash back every single month, a little bit over time. But the problem is nobody's buying mortgage servicing right now, and I'll explain why in a couple of minutes. So we're getting our money back within 15 days because we don't have to sell it to another servicer that might take 45 to 120 days to buy it. We're servicing it ourselves, and all we're doing is selling directly to Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, FHA, or VA, which will help keep us liquid and help keep the money flowing quickly. And that's one of the things I'm proud of in our ability to keep things moving so that we're not going to be in a position where our big old Amex card is maxed out and we don't have the money to fund the next loan. Okay, so got to worry about maxing out warehouse lines, got to worry about the cash crunch that comes with paying expenses without having any revenue. Then here's the coup de grace, okay? Early payoffs. Because the rates are so volatile, it has nothing to do with rates being volatile. When I do a mortgage, and this has been this way for years, when I do a mortgage and we sell the loan to Wall Street, to Fannie Mae, to Freddie Mac, we make a promise to Fannie Mae that they're going to make at least 6 months worth of payments on this loan. And if they don't, then we will forego any of the income we've earned by selling you this loan. And that's something that in the past they used to overcome with prepayment penalties, but prepayment penalties went away with the Dodd-Frank financial reform bill. So that's cool. We just build it into our cost of doing business. But think about that. If you were selling a home right now and there was a provision that said, hey, if you sell a home to the Smith family and the Smith family chooses to sell that house to somebody else in the next 6 months, you have to give back all of your commission that you've earned on the sale of the home to the Smith family in the last 6 months. That is exactly how the mortgage industry works. I lose my income, Summit Funding loses their income, none of us get paid. We get paid, and then we have to give it back. So early payoffs is somebody refinancing their home within that first 6 month window. It's why you hear lenders that aren't as truthful as I am. It's why you hear them say, oh, you can't refinance until 9 months after you have your loan. Like there's a minimum waiting period. You have to wait 9 months. If you've ever heard that, it's just plain not true. But it's the loan officer and the bank trying to protect their income. And that's a good thing, guys. You would do the same thing to protect your commission on a deal when you're closing on a house. But the truth is there is no waiting period after you do a loan to do another one. So if rates drop significantly, the guy that I did a loan for at 3.5% back in December might refinance right now at 2.5. And if he, no, it's not at 2.5 today, but pretend it was, then he'd refinance that loan. And guess what? I have to give back all of my commission. The company has to give back all of their commission on that loan that we did back in December. So huge problem with volatility when it comes to mortgage banks and our operating profitability. And again, guys, we're in a cash crunch right now in the mortgage industry, and it isn't about greed. It isn't about profit. It's about having enough money to survive. All right, I'm gonna pause for a second and breathe and take a look at chat and see if anybody has any questions. No questions. All right, here we go. So servicing values, I talked about this a little bit. I'm not going to go very far into it other than the fact that when the borrower does not pay, we have to cover most of the time the taxes, the insurance, the mortgage insurance, and sometimes the interest as well. And so there's some major downsides. So here's the deal. The current environment has driven servicing values in some cases down to zero. It used to be that a bank servicing book was worth 1% of whatever the face value was. It's now across the board 0.5%. Literally, banks have lost 1/2 of their assets of the servicing value, and that's killing the amount of their warehouse line because the warehouse line of credit is based upon the value of the company. So this is a very big problem that is continuing to exacerbate because each part of this puzzle impacts every other part of the puzzle, okay? So what's gonna happen next? The Fed we hope the Fed's going to step in and save servicing because that's the current problem is nobody wants to service the mortgages. That's why Summit Funding is now servicing all of our own loans. And if you're a big bank, you will service the mortgages and you're fine with it, but you're not going to necessarily want to service mortgages originated by other companies. You're not going to want to buy the servicing rights, but you'll happily service the mortgages you bring on. It's why a lot of the smaller mortgage companies that cannot service their own loans have significantly higher rates right now. Okay, my rates today are probably around 3.5. Some of my peers have rates at 4.5 because that's the best rate they can deliver because they have to deliver a significantly higher rate to get somebody to be willing to buy the servicing on the loan. The Fed is buying the investments, but nobody wants to own the servicing. And so that's the current problem. The second thing that's going on is the margin call issue. And so we expect FINRA, the SEC, or the Fed to provide some relief on margin calls, because literally banks are writing checks in the millions of dollars every single day as the rates continue to be significantly more volatile than we've ever seen. What do I expect? Oops, let's go back up. I also expect jumbo, FHA, and VA to continue to get harder to obtain, and I expect some mortgage banks will fail. It's the unfortunate reality. I don't wish it upon any of them. I know that Quicken, being the biggest mortgage bank out there right now, is having significant liquidity issues. I hope they don't fail. And as much as I hate Quicken, and I think they do a disservice to the industry for their lack, for the way they advertise that it should be, you know, hey, push button, get mortgage. And I don't know anybody who's ever pushed a button and actually gotten a mortgage to spit out the other end. But I don't want to see my industry fall apart. And if we lose a big player like that, that's going to spell bad news for the industry, and it's going to spell bad news for every single one of you. So we want to make sure that we do whatever we can to communicate. I want to make sure I do whatever I can to communicate what's going on in the market so that everybody is on the same page on the challenges that we're dealing with and how we need to work together to overcome those. All right, so I'm going to give some specific updates. Here's some new information that I did not have on Monday. Some of it's old. So many lenders are tightening or pulling out of FHA and VA loans. Here's the reason why. Because FHA and VA typically have a higher default rate. If people end up going into foreclosure, FHA and VA default at a higher rate. FHA will go down to a 500 FICO score per their guidelines. And FHA has not changed that guideline. Pretty much every lender that I've talked to has raised their minimum credit score to somewhere between 660 and 680 is pretty much the average minimum credit score for an FHA and VA that I'm hearing on the market right now. As of my presentation on Monday, I said Summit Funding is still at 550, but I would not be surprised if that changed. And it's a term that I learned back in 2008 called adverse selection. You don't want to be selected as the lender of choice for an adverse reason. In other words, a low credit score or high debt to income reason, because then a disproportionate amount of your book of business will be that low credit score, high debt to income ratio business. And you don't want to be the last one ever doing anything. So Summit Funding changed their position yesterday. And we announced that effective tomorrow, in other words, I have to disclose the loan today. Effective tomorrow, my minimum credit score on FHA and VA is 620. Now that is significantly better than most of my peers, but we've also added some overlays. That's extra rules, like we need to have some extra money in reserves. We need to have a little bit lower debt to income ratio for anybody between 620 and 639. If you're 640 or above, we have no additional overlays and we will do anything that FHA says can be done. It is business as usual. But guys, make no mistake, these rules are going to be fluid. FHA is not changing the rules, but mortgage banks are tightening them because of the cash crunch and the concern that if I loan to somebody right now that has a 581 FICO score in an environment where the economy is uncertain and we're headed into a recession, there's a higher likelihood that's going to have it some form of default or late payment. And I'm on the hook as the bank to make that monthly payment on their behalf every single month going forward. That is not a good bet to take. And that's why banks are pulling out of that market right now. So back up to the top, FHA now says they'll allow drive-by appraisals on purchases, but that's FHA's rule that came out on Friday. Banks have not yet digested that. I expect everybody to adopt it, but to be clear, it's got to be announced by the agency, and then it's got to be interpreted by the investors and by the banks to make sure that we're going to honor that. Okay. No other changes to overall guidelines from FHA. As I said, starting tomorrow, 620 minimum credit score. Here's a big one. Starting tomorrow, we are suspending all down payment assistance loans. I had a client that was searching hot and heavy, and last night when I learned this, I literally was starting to type an email to the agent saying, look, I know you got an offer out there right now. Do what you can to put it together. And before I press send, he emailed me saying, congratulations, we have an offer. And I called him and told him how lucky he really is. And I said, look, don't let the buyer buy something that is a bad home, but do whatever you can to keep this deal together. Because if this one falls apart, they're not going to be homeowners anytime soon. So you have to have your own 3.5% down payment. We can still, well, you can still hopefully get seller credits. And I think in this market is a good market to go after seller credits. And so somebody can buy a home still with as little as 3.5% out of their pocket if they have at least a 620 credit score, and it can be a gift from family. We just cannot use any down payment assistance programs. I want to be clear, CalHFA still exists. GSFA still exists. But many of my peers, if not a majority of my peers, have pulled out of it. And here's the simple reason why. Because they are taking now anywhere from 60 to 90 days to buy those loans. And there's a clause with every single one of them that if we don't have the loan sold within the first 60 days, they get to reach right into our checking account and pull out the entire amount of money for that mortgage. In other words, there is no warehouse line of credit we can leave it on. And that's just too high of a risk for mortgage banks to take right now, given the fact that there's very little profit for us in these down payment assistance loans. And so many other banks have pulled out. We have pulled out. I expect a significant majority of the banks to pull out of doing down payment assistance for the time being. We've officially said it's 45 days. You know, that's kind of like the governor saying that we are on lockdown for a certain amount of time. He has no clue. We have no clue. Okay. But the reality is that we are now not doing down payment assistance effective tomorrow, and most of my peers are in the exact same boat. We are also suspending all renovation loans. So 203K loans, renovation. We were really, really heavy into doing escrow holdbacks on homes that didn't meet guidelines, and it wasn't money we loaned to them, but we'd let them do the work after close of escrow. No more. Because we're worried about whether or not a contractor can get out there and do the work. We're worried. We have deals right now that the homeowner said, yeah, no problem. We'll get that work done after close of escrow. And then they closed escrow, moved into their house, and they refused to let the contractor into their house because they're afraid of the virus. Totally understand it. But the problem is the homeowner told us that they were cool with getting the work done within 14 days after close of escrow. And we closed the deal expecting that because we cannot sell it to Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac or FHA or VA until that work is done and we get the appraiser to prove the work is done. And we have homeowners who have changed their tune because, well, you didn't expect me to do that until this virus thing's over. I can't believe you expected that. And so we've had to now stop doing any escrow holdbacks and really any renovation products at all. All right. Any questions so far? Nope. All right. I'm going to keep going. Conventional. So appraisal waivers are awesome. So appraisal waivers are not a drive-by appraisal. An appraisal waiver is Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac using the data that they've aggregated. Every appraisal that's ever been done in the last 3 years has been submitted to Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac's portal. And they continue every single day to get every single appraisal that is done uploaded to their portal. So they continue to have more and more data about what houses are worth. They have really good data on, hey, if you're in this particular neighborhood and you're a four-bedroom home, how much is that worth compared to a three-bedroom home? Because they see on every appraisal done that 9 out of 10 appraisers give you $10,000 in value for that extra bedroom. I'm being hypothetical here. They use it against appraisers because if an appraiser said, hey, that extra bedroom is worth $15,000, then their system kicks back a request for the lender to contact the appraiser and ask why their adjustment is significantly higher than all of their peers that have only adjusted for $10,000 in that same market. Guys, that's been the case for the last 3 years. But about a year and a half ago, Fannie Mae said, gosh, we have such good information about values that if I got somebody that has strong credit and good assets and a low debt to income ratio, and it's obvious to me that the house is worth what they're paying for it, then I'm not going to require an appraisal. That's called an appraisal waiver. What's new is a drive-by appraisal. So now we are allowed to use drive-by appraisals instead of a regular appraisal, but only if we cannot get a regular appraisal. So we still have to request an appraiser to go out, but if the seller is refusing to let the appraiser into the home, or if there's no appraiser willing to accept the job, then we can convert it to a drive-by appraisal. Kathy, I'll get into refis. There's actually some changes on that, so I'll cover that. Guys, this third bullet point, I put a star on there because that's new information as of last night. This is huge. This is a bank-by-bank decision, but I've seen many of my peers already make this decision. So effective tomorrow, we will not use rental income on a loan unless we get a signed letter from the tenant saying they are not and will not be requesting a forbearance and proof the current month's rents have been paid. for those landlords. So if you're refinancing a home or if you're buying a home that is occupied, we have to get proof from the current owner that the prior months have been, that the current month is paid. And if it's paid in cash, we've got a problem because we can't prove they paid their current month. And we also need a signed letter from the tenant. Otherwise, we would have to qualify the buyer without counting the rental income, because the fear is right now, people are being told, hey, it's okay to not pay your rents. We're hearing it on the media right now because, hey, just like homeowners get a forbearance, tenants, don't worry about paying your mortgage, because paying your landlord, because your landlord can also skip their payment and get a forbearance. So everybody wins. Not so much. Okay. Our rule, our requirement as a bank is to make sure as of the day of funding that all income used is expected to continue without interruption. Well, if we're hearing on the media, everybody saying tenants don't need to pay their rent or negotiate with your landlord, then we got to make sure this tenant is paying by getting a letter from them and by getting proof that the current month has been paid. Significant changes, guys. This is temporary for the issues we're dealing with today, but it's very, very real and it will kill some deals. All right. You're asking the tenants to look into the crystal ball. Yes, we are. We're asking them to at least say at this point, we haven't asked for a forbearance, or how do we want to say it, that we're not going to request a forbearance. We have no intention. Let's put it that way. We have no intention of requesting a forbearance is maybe what I would advise a tenant to write. But if they're not willing to write it, we can't force them. And I would understand why they're not willing to write it. But that also means I can't count the rental income to help somebody qualify. All right, jumbo updates. I told you already that we went from 11 investors down to 2. As long as you've got 20% down and good reserves, you're good. But here's another trick that is a great option for somebody that really needs to get into that house and can't come up with enough money for the 20% down. We can do a conventional first mortgage and a home equity line of credit for a second mortgage, and we can go up to 90% of the value of the home. The catch 22 is that second is variable and it's tied to prime. Now, we're heading into a recession. I'm not sure how long it's going to last, but rates stay low in a recession. And so is that variable rate on that second mortgage going to stay low for now? Yeah, it is. But is it going to go up at some point down the road? Yeah, it is. And so is that worth it to your home buyer? I don't know. I'll clearly advise to them what their options are, but the truth is it's an option when somebody needs to buy that home or they've got a deal falling apart because the jumbo lender pulled their funding right before it was approved. Guys, having a locked loan doesn't matter anymore. Having docs out doesn't matter anymore. When these companies are shutting down, they are shutting down their pipeline. They are not funding anything else, and you're gonna run into that. You've probably already heard peers running into it. All right, turn times and closing issues. Yes, we can hit a 30-day closing. Matter of fact, on the down payment assistance loan that I got in last night, he wrote it for 25 days. I think we'll be good. we will be good. I'll make sure it happens. But here's the deal. We have some challenges. We must call the employer the day before or the day of funding to prove they have a job. I actually added a new slide since Monday on the next slide that I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. The IRS no longer is providing transcripts. So as of Monday, I didn't have an answer to that, but we got news on Friday of last week, the IRS has closed down their ability to send the department that sends out tax transcripts. And so I can't prove the tax returns that I got are really the ones that they turned in. And so we had about a 48-hour time frame that we didn't know what was going to happen. And now every investor has said, fine, forget it. We don't need the tax transcripts, but the homeowner needs to sign the form so we can go get them later. But we did win by waiving that requirement. But I added this whole new slide about verification of employment issues because this is becoming a bigger and bigger problem. So we must contact the employer the day of or the day before closing. And this is something I need your guys' help with. Every bank has a little bit different version of this. I'm going to give you our version. And if you follow our version, this is one area I'll tell you, I think we are more conservative than most of our peers. Okay, so if you follow my version, you know, good with everybody else, because although I think we're pretty aggressive on most things, in the case of verifications of employment, we're being more conservative than most of our peers. So we have to call the employer. Now we can also get an email from the employer confirming two questions, confirming that their hours and pay have not been negatively impacted and confirming the company is still operational. We need that person at HR to treat those answers like you are in a deposition and you are on trial. How do you answer a question when you're in a deposition? Yes or no? You don't add any more color. So when they say, have their hours and pay been negatively impacted? No. I don't want to hear, well, no, not yet, but there's a conversation about next week we might slow down a little bit and cut back some hours, and they're still trying to figure all that out. That is way more information than we need and could likely kill the deal. Because now we got to prove that isn't going to happen because we have knowledge that it could happen. They need to simply say, no. Now, if it has been negatively impacted, I'm not telling somebody to lie. I'm saying don't add more information than we need. So if the hours and pay have not been negatively impacted as of this moment, the answer is no. If the company is fully operational as of this moment, then the answer is yes, the company is fully operational. That is all they need to say. But we're having deals fall apart because people are adding way more information. Self-employed is a bigger challenge. So Summit Funding is creating a COVID disclosure for self-employed people where they are going to certify that in writing at the signing table, that their income has not been negatively impacted because of the COVID shutdown. On top of that, that disclosure doesn't exist yet. Our attorneys are creating it right now. On top of that, we have to get third-party verification. So I've got to get within the day of funding or the day before, I've got to get their CPA to confirm that, in fact, the business is still operational, or I have to get some form of third-party validation, maybe an invoice from a client that they just wrote a quote, got a payment from yesterday, or a quote that they wrote today to a client, something I can put in the file to show they're still actively practicing their business. And our funder will call the home buyer. The funder will call the home buyer and ask very simply, hey, Mr. Home Buyer, I am calling to confirm, I'm from the bank, and I'm calling to confirm that you are practicing your business and fully operational. Is that true? I have had none, but within our branch, we've had two buyers who have told the funder, no, I'm not operational, because they freaked out thinking they were going to get in trouble because they weren't on the allowable list. And so they thought, oh my gosh, I'm going to get turned into the government because I'm practicing business when I'm not supposed to be practicing business. And so across Northern California, we've had 8 of those in the last 3 days. We've only successfully solved one of them. Okay. And the only way we successfully solved it was a guy that was a gym owner. And we proved that he has converted his classes to Zoom classes, and he's teaching via Zoom, and he's paid on membership, and only 2 of his members have canceled. And so underwriting says, okay, yeah, that's cool. But when the call came in and he was asked, are you operating as normal? He said, no. That created a major problem, and they were lucky to solve that one. The other 7 still haven't been solved. Okay, so we've got to make sure that when somebody who is self-employed that's funding, and the day of or the day before funding, they get that phone call, are you fully operational with no changes to your ability to create income? The answer is yes, and I don't want them to lie, but they need to treat it like they are on trial, and either they are making money or they're not. Deals have blown up over this. All right. Jeff, would you like to take a couple minutes and talk? Kathy, yeah, I'll cover your refi reader. Question. I'll cover your refi question when Jeff finishes. So welcome, Jeff.
I'll give you a breather. Thanks, John, for inviting me. I tried to convince him that I was hired for my looks, but he didn't believe me.
Not at all.
Secondly, I guess everyone on the call, congratulations. We got past the end of the month. Let's see. On EMDs, we can still accept drop-offs at our office. We have a notice on the door because we are close to the public for the safety of our employees, you and your clients. They would just call the main number. The receptionist could meet them at one of the doors and then take it in and give them a receipt. We do recommend that they wire them if they do need wiring instructions. We do have a Start Safe portal on every deal. I'll get into that a little more in detail a little bit later. But yes, EMDs can still be dropped off at the office. We're utilizing mobile notaries since we no longer take in-office appointments. The mobile notaries have been very responsive, including the online ones like Notaries Express. We do, in some of our office, have a table and chair in the foyer if for some reason the person signing doesn't want to meet at their house. Next one. Remote online notarization. The American Land Title Association, I believe the California Land Title Association, is backing the Secure Notarization Act to enable nationwide the use of remote online notarization. some of the things that we could run into is we have to make sure that the lender's okay with it, and especially the recorder's office. Because today, which is surprising considering how technologically driven California is, we don't have a statute that allows it, if that makes sense. If there's any questions, I could probably expand a little bit. That's it in a nutshell.
Jeff, can you explain a little bit about what your understanding of how RON works? Because I know a lot of people on the call may have never heard this or need a little better understanding. And I know this is new and we don't have it in California. So give me just kind of a rough idea of what your understanding is of how a RON signing goes.
If I had to guess in the nation, I'd say 50% of the states accept remote online notarization and 50% don't. So what it allows, I mean, there's certain criteria that have to be met in order to be it, to have it, I guess, a legal notary, is a recordation of the interaction between the notary and the person that's being notarized. I also believe that all the documents, and they could be provided by us to the remote notary so they can review everything. And then they engage in like a video conference with the either the borrower or the buyer or the sellers.
Perfect. Thanks, Jeff.
Right now though, I think the concern is we have to pass it through the county recorder's office too. The majority of the recorder's office are online with e-recordings. I think in our general vicinity, the only one that isn't yet is Stanislaus County.
And then in the Sacramento market, we said all of the five counties in Sacramento, 4 out of 5 do e-recording, and the one that doesn't is?
YOLO.
YOLO. YOLO!
Sac, Placer, El Dorado. What other one out there? Yuba.
I believe
they're all e-record. And I haven't heard of anything in Northern California with regard to problems with e-recording. The only thing I would expect is maybe some of the recorder's office may scale back on their cutoff times for release of recordings. I think Sacramento County might have cut it back to 2 o'clock. San Joaquin County seems to be on a go-forward basis, business as usual, but the majority of the recorder's office are close to general public. So that could affect, in Stanislaus County, they call them mulligans, where they would allow a title company to actually walk on a recording by going up to the counter. For us in San Joaquin County, we do have a digital portal. Provided that we do receive the funds, we could digitally record through our portal, I believe up to 4 o'clock, but we need the funds by 1 o'clock. Any questions on recording? Back to the previous one, John, sorry. Oh. With regard to filed documents, the only reason why I bring up the importance of like county recording being closed to the general public and the San Joaquin Superior Court, I would expect Sacramento to be very similar, is probably one of the biggest transfer of wealth generations is the baby boomers until the millennials get old enough. And what we're seeing is in the event that we need certified copies of death certificates or there's an existing abstract of judgment against the seller and we're looking for a release, at least for the death certificates right now, we can order them online with San Joaquin County, but they're going to deliver it to us via mail. So the more you want to be very diligent in all the upfront information that you may have with regard to the owner. Abstracts of judgment and child support, code violations. On code violations, my impression with the city of Stockton right now is that they're still open. They will still do inspections, but they will only do inspections if the property is vacant. Abstracts of judgment. Typically what a title company would do is they'd look at the recorded abstract of judgment in the upper left. Usually there's an attorney and they would reach out to the attorney, but we've had some situations for Chicago, they would actually physically send me down to the courthouse to look at the court case to see if there was a filed release. Because a lot of times when an abstract of judgment is satisfied, the filed release will go to the attorney. That's why a title company will reach out to the attorney first. But sometimes, you know, this could be 8 years and the attorney could have closed up his practice. So secondarily, at least for Chicago, they would send me down to look at the court case. I can remotely look at a court case to see if there's a filed judgment, but I would expect the Superior Court to do the same thing the recorder's office is right now. If we do request a certified copy of it for recordation, they would probably send it to us via mail. So that could create a little delay. City of Stockton. Okay, next slide. Wire fraud. You know, in times like these, I think, you know, the attempts at wire fraud go up. So what we did was, you still as a real estate agent and lender, you want to be diligent. Instead of replying to all through an email, get in the practice of forwarding and putting the emails in fresh for the fear that phishing or someone spoofed your account. But we do have, to my knowledge, we're the only title company that actually has a two-factor authentication portal. So what happens is, when you open escrow, the escrow officer will ask for the best contact information for the seller and the buyer. In the case of a refi, the borrower. Within 24 to 48 hours, our system will send your buyers, your sellers, or your borrowers an email, where all they have to do is click to continue. So you do want to let your clients know that they're going to receive an email from us regarding StartSafe. And then they go into a little portal. It sends a 6-digit code to their cell phone number. That's the 2-factor authentication. And then they just answer simple questions. And then once they're completed, then it sends the information into our system, where it populates our system with all the answers to the questions that they answered. It is another place for buyers for them to access their wiring instructions. Because we actually want to pull it away from being in an email format, even if it's a secure email. So we want to get them a little comfortable with using the StartSafe system and being able to go back and access the wiring instructions, because it is a 2-factor authentication system. And we're also going to have a COVID-19 disclosure too. On the seller side, the documents that are in there would be a borrower authorization that they could digitally sign, and then also the COVID-19 disclosure. Any questions?
It's officially question time. So I have a question from Kathy. I'll get to in a second. Guys, if you have questions, jump into the chat. If you feel like it's more complicated and you want to discuss it live, then just tell me in the chat that you want to, and I'll call on you. Kathy does have a question right now, or Kathy Vaughn had asked a question a while back. She asked, how are refinances going? So first of all, the industry is inundated with refinances. Every bank is handling them different. The problem right now is refinances are creating a huge drain on the banks in two places. It's creating a huge drain in resources, and it's as far as people resources, and it's a huge drain on the hedge, the money that we have that we're guaranteeing those locks. And so what we're dealing with is a lot of banks changing how they're managing refinances. We're making a change that I think is actually a really, really good thing. So we are now going to lock our refinances once they're loan approved. What that gives me is a lot shorter time window of when I'm trying to close the deal, and we don't have to hedge for anywhere near as long. So we can deliver significantly lower interest rates because we're not hedging for a long period of time. It also decreases the overall cost of our hedge, and therefore we don't have to charge as much in interest rates across the board to make up for that. So we're also, the final piece of that that makes it actually really good is, most of the time a homeowner calls me and says, hey, I want to refinance. And I say, cool, here's today's rate. And they say, yeah, that sounds good, let's move forward. The truth is rates should be a lot lower than where they are today. The Fed's been buying mortgage bonds, and we expect them to be significantly lower as this huge wave of mortgages works its way through the system. And so we're telling our clients, look, we're confident you're going to get a better interest rate if you hold on, and we have time to time the market because we'll be ready to pull the trigger because we'll have the appraisal done, we'll have the loan underwritten. So refis are going great. We're just shifting our strategy on there that protects the homeowners, and it gives them the best flexibility to get the best rate and protects us financially. Turn time on that, Kathy, yeah, 45 to 60 days is typically how long we're locking them when we were locking them. Now it's probably still going to be about 30 days to 45 days for us to get it through underwriting, and then it will be able to be locked. But now they have another 90-day window from there to lock whenever the market makes sense. Penny, you were asking about the COVID-19 disclosure. So is that Jeff's disclosure you were asking about, Penny? Okay, all right. Penny says yes. Jeff, what is the purpose of your COVID-19 disclosure? Is it to ensure the EMD just, in case the deal falls apart? Yeah,
it's just prior to the signing, they just answer the questions. Have you been ill? Have you been exposed to anyone else that was, you know, that is diagnosed as COVID-19? It's not a very serious one, but it's one of those disclosures that we want to have up front, at least before the signing, because if they answer yes to, you know, like those two questions, we would have to cancel the appointment. Does that make sense?
Got it.
Okay.
So is that a violation of HIPAA?
I'm sorry?
She asked if that was a violation of HIPAA.
Is that a violation of HIPAA?
In what way?
In that you're demanding that someone disclose their physical, medical. Anything. For financial reasons. Well, that seems fishy.
Jeff's a salesman, remember. He's not the attorney.
I don't know. I'd probably have to ask with escrow operations management on that. I don't actually have a copy of what the notice says, but if you want, I can provide it to you.
Perfect. Kathy Vaughn, you wanted to talk. Yes, you can talk, and yes, I'll let you. So go ahead and unmute yourself. Can you find unmute? You need me to find you and unmute you?
There we go. I'm on it.
All right, perfect.
Okay, so there are two CRR is putting out new forms, and I just got done with the meeting with our broker this morning. They're not on CAR yet. There's one is a PEAD, and the other one's an RLA-CAA. The CVA, which is the coronavirus one, is an optional form that we can use. It coincides with the NUCC. So I would recommend everybody get on CAR, go to, I think it's underneath the advisory portion of it, the transaction and risk management portion of it, and then go underneath the Corona, and you'll see these new forms that are getting ready to come out. I'm pretty sure everybody's going to be using them pretty quick, FYI.
Well, thank you, Kathy. All of the acronyms left me CONFUSED, but I'm sure there's other people that have figured it out. So gang, we're coming up on the top of the hour. I will put in my plug. You know, obviously I put these things on not as a nonprofit organization, but to earn your trust and to earn your business. So if you have any people who are looking to purchase a home or any past clients that want to refinance, I'd be honored to have that opportunity to serve you and to serve your clients. I also would love the opportunity to share this message with all of the other realtors that you know. I'll be doing them every Monday at 3 o'clock, every Wednesday at 11 a.m. Until this all calms down. So probably like 2022, maybe. I'm kidding. I hope I'm kidding. I have created a simple website. It is RSVP with John. RSVP with John. So anybody you know that you think should join this, just say, hey, go to RSVP with John, and you can RSVP with John. So please help me share this great information and get people onto these calls. I am going to record it just to kind of break, you know, pull out some pieces of it that I think would be valuable to share, but I have zero intention of sharing the whole thing from start to finish because nobody wants to listen to me recorded 2 days later for an hour. But come join me for the live meetings because there'll be new information every single time. Teresa had said the car firms are already out. Thank you for that information. We've got 2 minutes left before I have to get on another Zoom meeting because that's kind of all we do anymore, right? Like we Zoom from one Zoom to another Zoom. If there's no other questions, then I will Zoom you all later. See you next week. Same bat time, same bat channel. And if you want to join me Monday, it'll be 3 o'clock. Thanks, gang. Bye-bye.
I missed you all.